Good evening to everyone. Good evening. I'll just ask folks if they're able to do so to see if they can find a seat. I think we have enough seats. And also to just organize yourselves in a way so that others can hear. Anyway, welcome to the debate. My name is David Drake, and I am part of the ministry team here at St. Paul's United Church, along with my ministry partner, Margaret Harper. There's Margaret over there. And so the only thing we want to say is welcome to this space and enjoy. And I'm going to just call on the moderator, introduce Maggie Ziegler, who is a resident of Salt Spring Island. She is a psychotherapist and an educator with a long history of involvement in community and non-for-profit organizations, both at home and internationally. So, thank you.
Thank you. Just want to welcome all of you and our three candidates here, Jim Kane for the Liberal Party, Alicia. Did I say Jim?
Yeah.
My notes say Tim. Jim. Thank you.
Sorry.
We need
to get
Tom.
I knew you were Tim. Jim Kane for the Liberals. Alicia Cormier for the NDP and Elizabeth May, our standing MP for the Greens. So welcome to all. So just to begin, we'd like to acknowledge that we're meeting on the traditional territories of the First Nations, who have lived for more than 8,000 years in these lands, and all the writings in the lower part of what we now call Vancouver Island are Coast Salish people's territory. And here we acknowledge that we're in the traditional territory of the Wasinich people, who signed treaties with James Douglas in the 1850s. Wasinich oral history tells us their chiefs made treaty with colonial authorities to avoid war and not to give up their lands. Specifically, this writing is home to the Sartlet, the Paquachin, the Seo, and the Sikkim. And we support the right of Aboriginal people to self-determination and want to express our commitment to the long-term process of reconciliation. I know we're all eager to get to the speakers and to hear what they have to say. But I'd like to just give a few minutes to representatives from the Dogwood Initiative and BCSEA, who have conceptualized and hosted a series of five debates on energy and climate. This is the last one. So thank you so much. And first of all, Tim Roberts from BCSEA.
Thanks, Maggie, and good evening to you all. Thanks so much for coming, all of you. Chicken Noodle was right. The sky has been falling in. Without several decades of wind flapping by millions of chicken noodles to focus attention on global warming, we'd be in an even sorrier state than we are right now. But we can't put all our eggs in that strategic basket. Flapping can become downright exhausting and depressing. Let's crow about solutions. They are happening at an astounding rate around the world and here in BC. Solar, wind, geothermal, and other non-fossil fuel energy solutions, energy efficiency and retrofitting solutions, community planning and transportation solutions. Innovative financing, taxation, and regulatory approaches may not be all that sexy, but they're also critical. And when we embrace these solutions, climate action is not a burden. It's an historic opportunity. BCSEA exists to advance these solutions at every level. This is why, in this election year, our chapter has made it a priority to foster informed debate on approaches and solutions in the federal sphere. We are nonpartisan. We've made every effort to secure the participation of all four major parties in this debate, and deeply appreciate that Alicia, Elizabeth, and Tim are here tonight. I'm sorry that the Conservatives said that they have a conflict tonight. We could not have undertaken this initiative alone. We have 27 fabulous volunteers helping us here tonight. We would also like to acknowledge the support of our sponsors who are shown on the screens above, not right now, but they have been. Van City Credit Union, CFAX, Generation Squeeze, and Moksha Yoga. And locally, we appreciate the wonderful refreshments that were donated by Level Ground Trading, Breadstuffs Bakery, and Moulin Vert Bakery. On the BCSEA side, I would personally like to acknowledge Marion Pape, who's hiding in the little alcove there. She is our chapter president, and it's her vision that has guided this series. And also, I'd like to acknowledge the indefatigable work of Tom Hackney, who is also in blue at the back here, too, BCSEA's policy director, in planning the format and questions for this debate. And then there are our partners. I'd like to turn the mic over to Alexis White, representing our amazing and valuable partner, the Dogwood Initiative. And she will introduce her organization and in turn, our other key partners in the faith community who've also been critical in this whole endeavor. Thank you.
Thank you, Tim. Welcome, everyone. It's been a privilege to co-organize this debate with the visionary BCSEA team and our partners in the faith community, EcoVision, the Unitarian Church, and our amazing hosts, David Drake and Margaret Harper, here at St. Paul's to provide this wonderful venue for tonight's debate, along with your assistance of their technical wizard, Anil Lau. They have all gone the extra mile to make this event happen, and so I'd like to give them a real thank you for what they've done. At Dogwood, we have the vision that every citizen in BC should have the right to be included in the decision-making process around any project or development that will adversely affect our land, our rivers, and precious coastal waters, and will ultimately contribute to climate change. It's been inspiring to see that over 250,000 Dogwood supporters throughout BC have pledged to take a stand in order to protect the health and well-being of our communities for years to come. What unites all of us is our love for this extraordinary place we are so privileged to call home, and a shared concern for our communities, our country, and our planet in the face of global crisis. And we're looking forward to hearing the candidates talk about this pressing issue and other topics tonight. Thank you for joining us tonight for this necessary discussion, and I invite all you to stop by the Dogwood table after the debate to sign the vote pledge if you haven't had a chance to do so. Thank you.
Housekeeping and then some guidelines, and then we'll just jump right into it. Washrooms are just down the hall here to the right and then the right again. Fire exits the back, here, and over there. I don't know if anyone's looking for childcare, but if you are, again, down the hall to the right and on the left. Photographs, flashes are okay. If it gets to be too disruptive, then a prerogative to ask you to turn the flashes off. In terms of our guidelines, we ask you to put your phones on silent, to leave the room if you want to take a call or make a call. We're going to have a very short stretch break, 5 minutes max. So please feel free to get up and use the washrooms when you need to. Or to get a coffee, or to write a question. You'll see there's people with pieces of paper standing around. Can you just wave the people who have, there's someone at the back. So if you want to write a question for the second half of the evening, just put up your hand and one of those people will deliver you a piece of paper and then a pencil. So we really encourage a respectful exchange and listening between the candidates and between the candidates and the audience. We've created a really strong structure that I think is really going to give us a way to get to the issues in a way that we can really hear and listen from everybody. And we're going to finish by 9 o'clock, so that's another reason why just take care of yourself as you need to as we go along. So, here's how it's going to go. The candidates are each going to have a 2-minute opening statement, And then there's going to be six rounds of questions, which are pre-written questions. The candidates have all seen them, and they will each get to speak to 2 minutes to those questions and have a choice of a 30-second rebuttal. And I'll emphasize this timekeeping again in a moment. These topics of these questions will relate to Canada's share of GHG emissions reductions, Enbridge and the Kinder Morgan pipelines, the National Energy Board, sustainable energy, green jobs, and lastly, fair treatment for the next generations. So we have a noble timekeeper here. His name is Jack, and I'm going to ask him right now to wave in the air the 30-second thing, so you can see it from all sides. It cannot be missed. And when those 30 seconds are finished, he's going to put up the stop sign, and I'm going to ring the bell. So that's how it's going to go. And when we get to the question period, which will be after our short break, we'll go over the structure for that. So just to say now that in that second half, we will be alternating questions from the mic and questions that have been written. So we hope to get through 8 to 10 questions. It depends on time, but we'll come back to that. I wanted to ask, we have one candidate in this riding who's not at the table here. Meghan Porter is a Libertarian candidate. Just wanted to ask, is she here? Not here. Okay. I was going to invite her to come to the head of the line at question period. So if anyone knows her, if she shows up, please pass on that message. Okay, I think we're ready to go. The speaker's order has been predetermined and gives each candidate equal opportunity of going first and second. And it's been done by lot. And I think you guys have a paper, but if you... You don't have any, you're going to be surprised each time. So for these opening statements, we're going to go Elizabeth, Tim, Alicia, so straight down the table. Okay, the first question. This December, at the United Nations Climate Change Conference in Paris.
Opening statement.
Opening statement. Thank you.
Well, I want to start by thanking the organizers as well. BC Sustainable Energy Association, the Dogwood Initiative. Boy, this feels really loud. Is this really loud?
Yes, yeah.
Okay, and of course, to all the other partner and sponsoring organizations, and Maggie for moderating. The questions that we're going to have next, we'll get into policy and platform in some detail. So I'm going to actually approach this as if it wasn't an election campaign. I was just talking about why climate change is the defining issue for all of us, and certainly is the driving force in my life. I would never have gone into politics if I hadn't been driven by concern about the climate crisis. I actually had the great benefit of learning my climate science before the myth of doubt was invented by the fossil fuel lobby. I learned my climate science in the mid-80s, when through complete fluke, since I wasn't a member of that party, I was recruited in the office of the Federal Minister of Environment to serve as senior policy advisor to Tom McMillan in the Brian Mulroney administration. I organized the first international scientific conference on climate change. It took place in the last week of June, 1988. We invited scientists from all around the world, and they put together a consensus statement. The conference, by the way, was called Our Changing Atmosphere Implications for Global Security. I wish we kept the focus on security. Politicians seem to care about security, but not necessarily about the climate. The opening sentence of the consensus statement was this: humanity is conducting an unintended, uncontrolled, globally pervasive experiment whose ultimate consequences could be second only to global nuclear war. Nothing has changed. we have enacted, and the deadline for action is coming up 40 days after this election.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Is this on?
Yes.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Good. Well, thank you to the organizers of the Maggie and my fellow candidates for being here. This is an important election. This afternoon I was talking to a friend and told him, I'm coming to this debate tonight. He said, what? You're going to that Dogwood sustainable energy debate? Isn't that going to be a love-in for the Green Party and the NDP? And I said, I don't know. Maybe it is. But you know something? I don't care. Because I'm a liberal. And liberals listen. And we take advice. And we take advice from scientists. So I'm so pleased to be here to hear from you and to answer the questions that I'm able to answer. And so what I want to do now is tell you a little bit about myself. I grew up in a family of nine. I was the eldest of nine. My father was a union leader and a strong NDP advocate. I worked on the NDP candidates' campaigns in Windsor, Ontario, many years. But then I came to my senses, you might say. But it was driven by the Right Honorable Herb Ray, who I've likened to Miss May in the way that that gentleman, parliamentarian, handled his constituency. I want to do the same here for you. I believe that we are in a crisis and that we need someone at government's table to make sure that we get action on climate change. And that's what I want to do for you. Besides fighting hard for fully funded healthcare, because I know how important that is. I'm a grandfather and a father of three, and I understand that that's important to us. So I'll talk about more about that later. Thank you.
Is that on?
Yes.
Oh, good. Thank you to everyone for being here this evening, and thank you to our organizers for allowing us this opportunity to discuss one of the most important elections in Canada's history. And I appreciate the recognition that we're on the Wasanich traditional territory, and for that I'm grateful for the privilege. I'm Alicia Cormier, your NDP candidate, and I've lived in this riding since 1969. I grew up in Sydney, and I've raised my family, worked, and volunteered in our community for over 30 years. I offer management experience in education, in healthcare, small business, and social enterprise. And I've been twice elected as a municipal councillor in Central Saanich. While serving on local government, I've been an outspoken voice promoting climate action, local agriculture, affordable housing, smart growth, and a healthy environment. Recently, I played a key role in a decision by the former council in Central Saanich, whereby they had wanted to designate rural land for future commercial and residential development. And this plan was not consistent with our regional sustainability strategy or our official community plan. And I'm proud to say that my efforts made a difference to protect several hectares of arable farmland and 14 small farms that are located there. I also founded the Saanich Peninsula chapter of Green Drinks. I'm running in this election because I can no longer sit by and watch Mr. Harper dismantling the country that I love. And I want to establish an NDP government for the first time in Canada's history with Tom Mulcair as Prime Minister. We have a unique opportunity to address issues like climate change and growing inequality, not by advocating progressive policies, but by actually forming government that will implement these policies. With your support on October 19th, we will form government and make Canada a better place. Thank you.
I
I see some action to try to resolve the microphone that was a little jerky for you there. So
it's consistent. They mispronounce his name and all the mic that's on the bridge.
That's true.
They often mispronounce your name too.
Oh, well,
yeah.
I'm used to that.
So let's see if I can start with question one and not question three. This December, at the United Nations Climate Change Conference in Paris, the nations of the world will meet once again with the goal of reaching, in the words of France's foreign minister, an ambitious, binding agreement on climate change that applies to all countries, enabling us to limit global warming to below 2 degrees Celsius. Meanwhile, the harm of climate change is ever more apparent. BC, Alberta, Saskatchewan have been ravaged by wildfires this summer, with thousands of people forced from their homes and many homes burned. Western North America and Brazil suffered record-breaking droughts, while parts of Eastern North America were hit by unseasonable rain and storms. And so it goes around the world. Canada and the world have failed to meet previous promises to cut carbon emissions. We can't afford to fail this time. The question is, what will you and your party do to ensure that Canada makes its share of the emissions reductions needed to achieve the goal of the Copenhagen Accord and limit global warming to below 2 degrees? And the order is, I have it by party, not by name, so I'm just going to read it that way through here. Liberal, NDP, Green, and the rebuttal will be in the same order.
Right.
So, Tim.
Thank you, Maggie. The question, didn't have a time limit, thankfully. But the fact is, the question is so absolutely true. We are in a crisis. We know that. And the Liberal Party has a plan to take on the challenge. Our leader, Justin Trudeau, has made it clear that if he's elected and he's able to form government, he will attend the Climate Change Conference in Paris in December, and he will invite all of the premiers to attend with him. It's almost novel to think that the premiers and the prime minister would get together after the last few years of Mr. Harper's regime, but that's what we'll do. From 90 days from that conference, Mr. Trudeau will meet with all the premiers once again to set national emission standard targets, reduction targets, and we're not going to impose a certain system like fee and dividend, cap and trade. Those are options. But in BC, we have carbon tax already. That's what our province has chosen to do. So we're not going to be imposing the method, but what we're going to be imposing are the targets. And our federal government will help the provinces to meet those targets. Thank you.
Thank you. Under Harper's watch, the Conservatives have withdrawn from the Kyoto Protocol. They've muzzled scientists, and they fired over 4,000 federal researchers and slashed $1.1 billion in federal spending on science and technology just in the last 4 years alone. So I'd like you to imagine on October 20th, if the NDP wins more seats than the Conservatives, this is what we'll do. Tom Mulcair and his team will go to Paris, and we will sign a binding agreement to reduce carbon emissions. And the plan that we have has been reviewed favorably by the Environmental Defense. It's rated it as the most stringent of the parties. And the CCPA, which is the Canadian Centre for Policy of Alternatives, has indicated that the Green Party fee and dividend plan is aiming too low. The other things that the NDP will do is cabinet decisions will be made through a climate lens. We'll price carbon and we'll set national targets and implement the cap and trade, which works very well with the carbon tax as well. We'll remove billions of subsidies from fossil fuels and we'll insist on enacting a polluter pay system. We're also going to invest in transit, in clean energy, in energy-efficient commercial buildings, as well as help people retrofit their homes. These and other initiatives will move us away quickly from a dirty and a dying, costly industry that requires workers to work away in the tar sands, not in their home community. And we have plans to help with that as well. Thank you.
I'm going to focus a bit more on the challenge of the COP21 that opens on November 30th this year, 40 days after our election. We're going to have to hit the ground running, folks. We can't afford to waste a single minute. Once Harper is gone, we're figuring out a new parliament, a new government. I'll be on the phone with Mulcair and Trudeau immediately, whoever has the right balance for us to work with them and say, look, we've got a lot of work to do. We have to have much more ambitious targets than we have right now. And even before we go to Paris, not afterwards, we need to also pull together the A-team of Canadian diplomats and negotiators. We need to bring back the people who are respected around the world, which means, frankly, moving aside the negotiators that the rest of the world has grown to hate under Stephen Harper. We need to hit the ground running and go to the Paris negotiations, not to accept just any treaty, but to actually take the lead again to drive the world to deeper targets for a more ambitious treaty overall. I've been in the climate negotiations. I'm the only opposition member of parliament to have attended for years, and I can tell you, they are not impressing anyone right now. We are well short. The combined targets of every country so far fall short of avoiding 2 degrees, and preferably we should stick to 1.5. We have a lot of work to do. Once we get back from Paris, how do we make sure Canada hits those targets? Tough fees on carbon pollution, redistributed as dividends. The fee and dividend plan of the Green Party is the most costed and effective, plus energy efficiency measures. 30% of our carbon pollution comes from buildings that are inefficient, plus investments in public transit, plus we have to ensure that we no longer have coal-fired electricity across Canada, and the Green Party is the only party in this election committed to stopping the growth of the oil sands so that we can move to a clean and green, sustainable economy.
I congratulate you all on your thoughtful, careful, time-limited responses. And let's see how we do on the 30-second rebuttals. There'll only be a stop sign going up, no warning. And on the rebuttals, we're going to go in the same order. It's optional, but it'll be Liberal, NDP, Green. So, Tim, do you?
Yes, I do. Thank you very much. And Ms. May is correct. We do need to take action, and there is a wide range of actions to be taken. The Liberal Party has a fulsome plan, and I ask you to go to realchange.ca to see some of the details of that. But we do, one of the things we're going to do right away is end fossil fuel subsidies. We're going to end accelerated capital cost allowance on tar sands equipment. So those are the first two steps that we'll do. I guess my time's up.
Perfect.
Yes, I guess for the rebuttal, what I would like to is just draw attention to Mr. Trudeau has indicated that he will consult when he's back from Paris, which means that he'll be going to Paris for the climate summit without a plan and without targets. And I think that there's a lot of questions to be answered around that approach, and perhaps I can give my time the rest of it to Tim to respond.
Well, thank you. I'd be happy to respond to that because
I don't want to rip out anything. I think that, but I do want to read something because I recommend it to you that it just came out. Environmental Defense, the Canadian Environmental Organization, has compared all the major platforms and parties. And really, the NDP and Greens get lumped together quite a bit here. I'll just read. The NDP and the Greens have both set ambitious carbon reduction targets for 2025, which commit to greater emissions reductions and a faster time frame. The Greens would commit $500 million per year while the NDP pledge remains undefined for climate financing. The Green Party is also unequivocally opposed to all pipeline proposals, etc. So this is online. You can find it. It's very helpful.
Thank you all. We'll move on to the second question, which is about Enbridge and Kinder Morgan. In the past few years, two major energy export proposals have caused much controversy in BC. These are the Enbridge Northern Gateway Pipeline Project and Kinder Morgan's Trans Mountain Pipeline Expansion Project. Proponents claim a wide range of benefits, including employment and economic stimulus. Opponents cite several concerns, including First Nations rights and the risk that oil spills would devastate BC's coastal ecology and communities. Northern Gateway would carry diluted bitumen from the Alberta tar sands across BC to Kitimat, where 220 supertankers per year traveling through BC's coastal waters would load that bitumen for export. Trans Mountain would carry the same product to an oil tanker port in Burnaby. This would increase tanker sevenfold in the Burrard Inlet and southern BC's coastal waters to over 400 tankers per year. The question is simple. What is your position on each of these proposals? The order is Alicia, Elizabeth, and Tim.
Thank you. Well, Enbridge is a non-starter because the plan to ship raw bitumen through some of the most dangerous channels on Earth is just not on. And even if the plan was to ship it inland, the current NEB, the National Energy Board, could not provide a report which the NDP cabinet could support. The NEB is has been a corrupted industry captured regulator. And in the case of Kinder Morgan, its crude approach is now very transparent. It's refused to hear First Nations. It's refused to hear scientific evidence. It's refused to explore whether Trans Mountain has its social license. And it's a question of whether it will apply a climate lens is not even on the table. So the NDP, under the leadership of Tom Mulcair, would reinvigorate the NEB, and these would be the six questions that it would have to answer. Will the proposal help us to meet our Paris targets, or would it undermine our ability to do so? It's called the climate lens. And we would look at whether or not it lives up to the commitments of First Nations, and whether it includes the concept of polluter pay. And we would look at the social license. So people like you would have an opportunity to speak to the Energy Board about its impact on our communities. And it would be based on the best science and best economic advice. So we'd look at the analysis of jobs that it would create and those that it would do without. And we would look at whether or not the review was fair to everybody. What I'd like you to consider is that on October 19th, if a conservative government is re-elected, Enbridge, Trans Mountain, Kinder Morgan, Energy East, and Keystone will likely all proceed, not a reality that I want to wake up to on October 20th. Thank you.
Thanks. Well, I'd love to expand that question from Enbridge and Kinder Morgan to throw in Keystone and Energy East, because all four current pipeline proposals are operating for the same purpose, to ship solid raw bitumen out of Canada to be exported somewhere else. In order to ship raw bitumen, you have to make it flow. So each one of these crazy pipeline schemes involves a two-way flow. First, you have to ship toxic diluent, which is a fossil fuel condensate, basically naphtha, to which they add cancer-causing benzene, and they add butane, lighter fluid, and then they mix in the bitumen. What could go wrong? 70 to 30 mix of bitumen and diluent, which the industry brilliantly calls dilbit. The whole purpose of making dilbit is to get a solid material to flow through a pipeline. Then they want to put it in tankers and ship it to another country for refinery jobs there. None of this makes any sense, but it's part of the rip and strip mentality for maximizing oil sands growth to keep having more mines, more bitumen, shipped out with more risk. This doesn't need a process to figure out, is this a good idea? This is a bad idea from the get-go. I don't care what kind of process you put it through, what kind of lenses and filters you apply. The Green Party of Canada, and as your Member of Parliament, I will unequivocally oppose any expansion of the flow of Dilbit to the coast of BC. I will oppose putting Dilbit in pipelines where it can break and destroy inland waters, and I will oppose putting one drop more in tankers, and we will put in place a moratorium on tankers from our coastline going back to 1972, which means the current level of shipment by Kinder Morgan will be reversed. We cannot have Dilbit being shipped out of Burrard Inlet, full stop, period.
Yeah.
Thank you. The first thing that the Liberal government will do is formalize a moratorium on crude oil tanker traffic on BC's north coast. Now, do we oppose all pipelines? No. As a party, we don't. But what we do is respect communities. Mr. Trudeau was here a few weeks ago, and he said, governments can issue permits, but it's people who issue permission. Now, getting to the Northern Gateway Pipeline, we've said no to that. We're not going to go there. It's not the right. It doesn't have community support. On Keystone, we are going to support that. We have said that publicly. But that's a decision that the Americans have to make. It's a U.S. pipeline taking Gilbert down to Louisiana, I believe. So if the Americans want to build that, that's fine. Trans Mountain, that's not fine. We would have to re-study that because it hasn't been through a rigorous process. So we are going to reinvent the National Energy Board. We're going to put members of that board from all across Canada, from all walks of life, including environmentalists. It's not going to be a rubber stamp for the oil and gas industry anymore. Now, can a pipeline taking Dilbit from Calgary or Edmonton rather to our coast pass that? I don't think so. And so I'm going to rely on science and a reinvigorated National Energy Board to make that decision for us.
The 30-second rebuttals or comments, same order.
Yes, thank you. With all due respect, if all it took to stop Kinder Morgan and Enbridge was one or two Green MPs in the House who share our values, the NDP would have done something to stop this 100 times over. It takes a government. And I'm asking you to consider your vote as to whether that is what you want to see happen after October 19th. Thank you.
The part about elections I hate is the politics. I can't wait till the election's over. I hope to continue as your MP so we can get back to work. The reality is that as your MP, I'm an intervener in the NDP process. I'm continuing in a process that I think is inherently corrupt for one reason only. I hired Clayton Ruby, and if they approve the process, the project, I'm suing them. On the basis of breach of natural justice, I will fight Kinder Morgan in Parliament, I will fight it in the courts, and we will stop it.
Yes.
I was a public servant for 8 years in Ottawa, and after that, I worked for the president, the chairman of the National Energy Board. So I know that the National Energy Board, Roland Priddle was his name, and he was a great deputy minister of EMR in those days. And he was a solid chair of the National Energy Board. It has lost its way under Mr. Harper's regime. It's not fulfilling the job that it was meant to do. It has become a rubber stamp. Liberals will change that to make it fair. Thank you.
Getting so involved in what you're saying, bring all of you, bring my mind back to the question number three. which is about the National Energy Board specifically. The National Energy Board proceedings that reviewed the Enbridge and Kinder Morgan pipeline projects have themselves become controversial. The Enbridge project, approved by the federal cabinet in 2014 on recommendation by the National Energy Board, is now the subject of over a dozen court challenges, one of which is going on. Over half of British Columbians oppose it, and over 60 First Nations bands have signed the Save the Fraser Declaration in opposition. The Kinder Morgan review process continues, but already participants have withdrawn, claiming that it does not provide for a fair assessment of the merits of the project. The question, what changes do you feel are necessary in the way the federal government reviews energy infrastructure projects so as to maintain public trust and ensure that people's concerns are properly considered and the relevant costs, benefits, and risks are appropriately addressed? Elizabeth, Tim, Alicia.
First thing I want to say is that if we had a national energy strategy, a national energy policy, we wouldn't be stuck on the stupidity of the idea that the shipment of raw bitumen to other countries for processing makes any sense. But to the issue of process, if we go back to before the spring of 2012, before Omnibus Budget Bill C-38, the National Energy Board had nothing to do with assessing the environmental impacts of pipelines. Not their job, they haven't a clue how to do it. We had a Canadian Environmental Assessment Agency operating under a Canadian Environmental Assessment Act, which was repealed in Bill C-38. The other thing that happened in C-38 was they said, okay, environmental assessments of pipelines will be done by the NEB. But we'll make sure that under the NEB Act, wherever a pipeline is going to be located, the Navigable Waters Protection Act will no longer apply. The Fisheries Act will no longer apply. The Species at Risk Act will no longer apply. Pipelines trump everything. What else could be wrong with the NEB? To be a member of the board of the National Energy Board, and this is under their act, you have to live in Calgary. We have to start over. We have to get rid of Bill C-38. I often visualize the last great omnibus budget bill in which we repeal C-38, repeal C-45, repeal C-51, until we get back the laws. And then we need tougher environmental review within a policy for climate and energy. I don't think we'd even be reviewing pipeline projects that make no sense for this country. But if we are going to review them, we need a rigorous environmental assessment that includes assessing climate impacts, which used to be the case before C-38, and we need to revise the National Energy Board so it's no longer a rubber stamp for shipping offshore because of having to take into account Canadian interests.
You won't hear an argument from me on that, because this is what we need. And there's only one way to get that, is with the Liberal government. The Liberals are committed to doing this. You know, there was a time when people trusted their government. Well, we're not trusting them now. And when National Energy Board and the Harper Conservatives are calling environmentalists terrorists, you know, they're on the wrong path. Mr. Trudeau has said that with friends like Harper, the oil patch doesn't need enemies. And we know that that's true. We will restore the process that allows Canadians to express their views. We'll open up the National Energy Board. It won't be just people who live in Calgary who would be on that board. It would be a broad representation that would include environmentalists, include more scientists, because it's science and engineering that have to make the decisions on these things. Ultimately, we would also include First Nations peoples because it's about communities and technology and science. And if we can't come to a common ground and a consensus on the future of pipelines, any pipeline, then it's not going ahead. Full stop.
Thank you. So unlike Mr. Harper, the autonomous care the NDP is committing is committed to making evidence-based decisions, and we're committed to transitioning Canada to a low-carbon economy. We're also committed to implementing the recommendations of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, and we're committed to a fair process, and the rule of the law of NEB will ensure fair treatment for everyone. Some of the specifics that the NEB will be asked to address in its evaluation are: how many jobs for Canadians will it create? How many jobs might be lost? What's the potential environmental and climate risks? And have the costs been of implementing polluter pay been factored into the proposal? Have First Nations been treated as full partners in the development? What will be the impact on communities? And what are the net benefits to Canada now and in the future? Does the proposal create a sustainable path for Canada once the resource has been extracted? And Mr. Harper has acted as if we are in a poor country in need of selling to the lowest bidder. The NDP has more faith in our land and our people, and we're committed to sustainable economic development in the brighter future. And I also just want to, it is a political process, and I do want to poke a jab because Mr. Kane does use the word trust quite a bit. And the Liberals said they wouldn't raise the GST, and they did. They said they wouldn't reduce post-secondary and affordable housing funding, and they did. And we know about Bill C-51. They're not committed to repealing that bill. So be careful with the word trust. Thank you.
Rebuttal in the same order, starting with Elizabeth.
I don't find the need to speak on every point, and I don't see any need to rebut at the moment. I'd love to expand on why I would want to reform and repeal C-38, but I think everyone understood my first point.
Thank you. I do use the word trust a lot. You're so right, Alicia, because we've lost faith in our government. We've lost trust in our current government, and we need a government we can trust. Alicia's a bit loose with the facts, because the fact is, Mr. Trudeau has said repeatedly that we will amend and repeal C-51. There's no question about that. We know it's bad legislation, and it has to be changed. We knew, though, that security experts have told us, and at a committee,
last one, we're here on this question goes to you.
I thought I had my rebuttal.
Not yet. Did you? You didn't?
Yep.
No, you didn't. You have 30 seconds more. If you want it.
Well, I'll take it. No, I won't.
You'd have to have a cooperative, consensual decision.
That was okay. I can always talk more about
safety. And that's why we made it optional. It's like it's not required here.
Right.
So, question number 4 is on sustainable energy. Around the world, more and more financial and intellectual capital is being invested by governments and businesses alike in industries that use renewable, non-emitting resources like sun and wind. The question, what role does renewable energy have in meeting Canadians' energy needs in the future? And what are the main planks of your party's platform to support and encourage renewable energy? Liberal, Green, NDP.
Great, thank you. The answer is yes, of course. Renewables are the future for Canada. Fossil fuels have to be phased out. There's no question about that. Is it realistic to think we can stop driving our internal combustion cars tomorrow? No. We need to phase it out. We need to do it responsibly. We need to do it as quickly as we possibly can. The Liberal plan is to phase out fossil fuels through tax incentives to green and sustainable energy companies and technologies. We also want to work closely with the United States and Mexico to make North America a leader in energy conservation and sustainable energy technologies. As Ms. May said, and she's correct, we need a Canadian energy strategy, not the National Energy Program that was so popular in the 1980s, but a strategy that is built cooperatively by provinces and territories and the federal government as a leader, taking into consideration First Nations and bringing First Nations to the table, and environmentalists and scientists, because science and technology is our future. These problems that we have today can only be overcome with conservation, of course, that's a good first start for each and every one of us. And then science and technology and the advances in those things that will give us new technologies, and that's going to be our future.
To add to the preamble to this excellent question, and it is good news, so I like sharing it. The year 2014 was the first year in our history as an economic industrial society, first year globally, where investments in renewable energy outpaced investments in fossil fuels. Now that's the people who want to make money, right? That's not, you know, wanting to impress Greenpeace. This is people who are putting their investment billions and they're putting it on renewables. I don't know how many of you saw Mark Carney's speech recently, former governor of the Bank of Canada, now Bank of England governor, saying, you know, fossil fuels are stranded assets. We shouldn't be investing there. It's not going to make money anymore. This is a very significant turning point. So what do? Number one, Canada should join the International Renewable Energy Agency where information is shared and work is harnessed. We are the only industrialized country currently not a member. We have to domestically end fossil fuel subsidies, excuse the marketplace to give fossil fuels a break. We don't want to give fossil fuels a break. We want to get rid of them. In terms of specific spending, and by the way, our platform and our budget are all online at greenparty.ca, we put significant money into renewable energy two ways. One is a sustainable generations fund, which includes $1 billion a year to commercialize green technology, including renewables. It also, in our budget, we put $1 billion a year to something you might not have thought was important, but improving the infrastructure for east-west electricity grids. We need to be able to sell renewable energy into Alberta. Alberta needs to shut down its coal-fired power plants. The electricity generating sector in Alberta produces just as much greenhouse gases as their oil sands. We need to move to a solar roof program for homeowners. We fund that. We have a wide range of programs to spur renewables, wind, tidal, solar, geothermal. We do not need energy that's going to kill future generations.
Thank you. The global clean energy market is huge. It's expected to more than double to $1.8 trillion over the next 7 years. Canada's current share is less than 1% of this market. Why is that? Well, according to Maren Smith of Clean Energy Canada, Ottawa has its head in the sand. Harper refuses to look past fossil fuels. And recently, Rachel Notley got a letter from a consortium of clean energy companies representing $4.5 trillion in assets, wanting to come to Alberta because she is setting climate targets. Go figure. So what the NDP will do, in addition to signing the Paris deal, will price carbon and will stop subsidizing fossil fuels, starting with $240 million per year, and will redirect that into the clean energy sector to give it a kickstart. $1.3 billion in transit, we'll all enjoy that. Funding for innovation and research and development, that will go a long way. As well, we're going to provide incentives to create energy efficient buildings And announced today was the introduction of green bonds, which are going to allow Canadians to safely invest up to $4.5 billion in renewable energy and clean technology as part of our plan to power up 2 million homes with clean, renewable power. And the future is bright, but again, it's going to require government. On October 19th, please consider the NDP as that opportunity. Thank you.
Okay, 30-second comments, rebuttals.
Is it me first?
That's, you are first.
Oh, no, I'm fine with that.
I just decided it would be more fun in this debate if we pretended the conservative was here. Everything we really want to say is directed to the empty chair. So to the empty chair, why did you guys, in the budget this year, apply a new tariff against solar panels? When Canadians want to be putting solar panels on their roofs, we don't need to find out they're going to cost more. Because, and I met with Joe Oliver and I asked him not to do it, he said, oh, I didn't know we were doing that.
I'll reiterate that you know, the clean energy revolution is strong and it's well underway. And you know, despite the lack of support from the Conservatives, clean energy, we've attracted $11 billion in investment, and that has created significant jobs and wealth. And as well, we didn't hear about it, but the during the visit of the Prime Minister from India, the trade deal that was announced was focused on uranium, is what we heard, but in actual fact, 63% of that value was from solar companies.
Thank you all for your kindness and equanimity in having these giant badminton rackets waved in the
It's very effective.
It seems to be. Okay, the next question. Is about green jobs. The question is short, the intro is slightly longer. Providing good jobs for people has always been challenging in a competitive world. But it is now increasingly clear that our economic activities are destabilizing our whole planet's climate system, and that this threatens our health, well-being, and prosperity. Green jobs are designed to be compatible with a healthy environment that will sustain human life. And so the question is, what vision do you and your party have for green jobs in Canada, and what role does the federal government have in achieving that vision? And the order is NDP, Liberal, Green, so right to left. Well, I didn't mean it that way. Well.
It's your left to right.
Okay, your 2 minutes are starting now.
Okay, I'm relying on my notes because there's lots of good stuff to share. By 2022, it's expected that over 100,000 Canadians will be employed in the clean energy sector, and that the that's going to as well provide other opportunities for people to work closer to their homes. So unlike the Conservatives, we know what's good for the climate is also good for jobs. And unlike the Liberals who don't have a plan, or Greens who unfortunately won't be able to implement their platform because they won't form government, the things that we will do is 31,000 quality jobs through investing in transit. $200 million will be spent for creating co-op and internship jobs so that students who are studying at university and colleges, and particularly in clean energy and innovation, will be able to get paid internships to further their experience and their opportunities to take a step up the employment ladder. We'll also invest in trades and that will go into supporting the retrofits as well as affordable housing commitments that we're making. And, you know, $15 a day quality child care may not seem like it adds to clean jobs, but that will enable a number of parents to enter the workforce who are being held back because of high child care expenses.